Good morning and welcome. So today what we want to do is explore, I think, one of the most important questions we should all be asking ourselves, and certainly one of the most topical questions. I don't know, as a moderator, if I've ever been given so much fodder so quickly in the last few months. We have Apple, the government, we have the current prime minister, really front and center of a current discussion and debate where over 200,000 documents released. And it all comes back to the same question. What does accountability mean today? And more specifically for this group, what extra duty of care do social entrepreneurs have in being accountable? Are there good actions, like the people in the panel are going to talk about, actually doing unintentional harm? And how can we avoid doing unintentional harm? So I just want to ask a few questions, because I think it really frames how complex this topic is, but how important it is. So how many of you use Twitter? So probably 50 or 60%. How many of you have ever participated in what we would call a civic campaign associated with Twitter? So Black Lives Matter, yes, the yes vote in Ireland, or yes to all women. How many of you have done anything that had a civic hashtag associated with it? So probably 30 or 40%. So the question is, all of that's traceable. And traceable, what does that mean to you, the individual? Does that mean that the government now knows that you feel very strongly about the yes vote, Black Lives Matter? Do you care that they know that you feel a certain way? Does a corporation have the right to sell your particular political view about this to a third party, to a political candidate? You know, these are really important questions. How about booking.com? How many of you have ever used booking.com? I know okay. So 30 or 40%. How many of you have ever read the privacy policy of booking.com? One. Okay. So those of you that did not read the privacy policy, did you know that your data is available to any corporation for the next 5 years? That booking.com has the right, if they want to make an additional revenue stream, but their cookies are present, and everything that you book and go and see and whatever you do, whatever hotels you stay in, what your preferences are there and available for 5 years. So that really comes to the heart of the matter, is that do we really know, by doing these innocent things, sometimes very good things, where does that data go? And what's the accountability that we have to the people that we're trying to help? So with that, I'd like to open it up, and I'll start with you, Melanie, and tell us what your view is. Who has permission to you in the digital space, especially from your social entrepreneur point of view? Would you like to sit? Yeah, you can stand, yeah.
Well, first of all, thanks, Alexsis, and thank you, Skoll, for bringing together all of us to talk about this. It's something that's really very close to our heart. And I thought I would give a snippet, first of all, about what we do, why we do it, and how we do it. And then I'll get you to why we believe the philosophy that we hold in our policy we hold around privacy of information is so important. First, I want to bring you to the context. I just brought a few slides. I know we're not supposed to show text here, but I think a picture is worth 1,000 words, especially my words. So let me bring you to the environments we work in at Mobile Metrix. We're a consumer insights and marketing services company that serves the base of the pyramid. We work in Brazil and currently in the United States in low-income communities. And we are gathering information, including personal information. Our goal and our objective is to link those who have the critical and essential products and services to those who need perhaps those essential products and services the most. And of course, we're trying to create a win-win so that the companies who are looking for information and understanding of these low-income populations, as well as perhaps a market entry, can be balanced with the people themselves who need this essential information, products, and services. So that's our objective as Mobile Metrix. I should say fundamentally, we believe that accurate information is the fundamental first step to solving any social problem. Again, accurate information, we believe, is the fundamental first step to solving any social problem. So how we go about doing it is by collecting and hiring, if you will, young adults in local communities in these favelas or in the public housing projects in New York City, for example, who go door to door collecting the data. And I think, I said a picture's worth a thousand words, perhaps a video is worth a million more. So I've got just a brief snippet showing our work in action so you get an idea of the types of data that we're collecting. Mario, thank you.
The project Open Doors Knowledge from Within created a bridge between Unilever and these consumers by establishing a relationship of respect and trust. In partnership with Mobile Metrix, local young adults were equipped with cutting-edge technology and trained to understand the hygiene habits of slum residents and how these individuals feel about their communities. In the focus of the research were women, who were family home providers of four communities. In Rio Rocinha, Brazil's largest slum, with a population of over 80,000, and Morro dos Macacos, one of the city's most violent slums, with a population of 19,000. In Recife, Chão de Estrelas, located in the outskirts of the city, with a population of over 28,000, and Brasilia Teimosa, a slum nearby upscale neighborhoods, with a population of approximately 25,000. 86 mobile agents conducted the door-to-door data collection. 16,520 Lifebuoy soaps were distributed, in addition to educational brochures and flyers for the entire family. 16 lectures on hygiene were held, including a raffle of 1,200 Puret water filters. 4,130 homes were reached. A pioneering initiative of Unilever Brazil with Mobile Matrix.
Criamos modelo novo para Unilever Brasil, que escalável para outras comunidades, sempre respeitando a cultura local. E fizemos isso atuando em parceria com os próprios moradores, que foram treinados para entrevistar e ensinar a seus vizinhos hábitos de higiene. Essa relação de proximidade com a comunidade nos permite legitimar a entrada da Unilever, tanto para novas pesquisas, quanto para atuar com o seu comércio, o que é uma importante vantagem competitiva, dado o crescimento do poder econômico desse consumidor.
So we've also done work besides with Unilever, with Johnson & Johnson on dengue fever. We're doing work in nutrition in the public housing of New York City currently. And the information being collected is very, do you mind if I have the lights? That'd be great. I'm looking at a dark audience. Thank you. Is very personal. Because we're hiring local young adults who go to door, this information often is around their health concerns, their income, their expenses. And what we decided from day one, our policy was never to give away personal data. So we know we're collecting it, and we know that this model has generated a lot of people to give up a lot of information. It's kind of like if you guys go to your neighborhood and you sit down with your neighbor and you start chatting. That's what's happening here by having the young adults. And people just tend to very much open up. They'll open up about who's in the gang in their family. They'll open up about, again, their personal health issues. They'll open up about their income. And we took really upon ourselves to say, that's great, because not only do we get data, but we get great insights. But it's something we felt really at the heart, very socially responsible for. And so we have created a policy, and to this day have stuck to it, to never give away personal data. Again, like I said, it's very up close and personal type from the sourcing of the data. So Alexsis mentioned, where does the data come from? What kind of data? So it really gets into an array. Again, I think there's benefits to that, obviously for companies, but also for government, for nonprofits, to understand those insights. But to connect it to the person is where we draw the line. Not to say we don't get the personal data and the person's information, telephone, address. That's really critical. Why? It's because often we go back and we're asked to do impact assessments. So we need to find that same person to be able to see the trends and project what's really changed or hasn't changed after an intervention has taken place. I just want to highlight the policy, again, that's from day one, that we've always said that information would never be given out personally, so it's aggregated information that goes out the door. And again, I think what really is what's in it for companies, because people say, right, well, how do you guys make money? Well, the model is such that not only do after collecting the data, there's always, I mentioned the marketing services component. So that's where I think the company gets the most bang for their buck, because they're being offered information around, in this case, could be nutrition or hygiene habits. They're offered, again, bars of soap from the company. So it's a way of reaching the customer, not necessarily having them their personal information. But then there's also seminars that we would give. In this case, also a raffle to the consumer of a product. In this case, it was a water purifier by Unilever. So that bottom line is that, you know, our policies are very strict, and we feel very strongly about that. There are ways to reach the customer without having to connect it to the personal data.
So Melanie, that's a good segue, connecting personal data and your mission. And so Toby, do you want to talk about that a little bit? Because that's really at the heart of what your organization does.
Yeah, definitely. So this is a contentious and it's an increasingly important topic. My team, we work with mobile biometrics, but I think there's lots of mobile data, or increasingly organizations on the front lines all over the world using one form of mobile data. One thing I'd say to kick off, it's that although this is contentious and sometimes can be difficult, it's also a huge opportunity. You know, our team approaches this very much with a feeling of cautious optimism, pragmatic optimism, about the power of digital in the current age. I'm seeing increasingly on the front lines health workers who are delivering better quality care and reporting faster health information because they're using mobile phones, or increasingly now low-cost Android tablets and smartphones on the front lines, sometimes with diagnostic capabilities on device, which is really exciting. My colleagues who work in mobile finance, say Bcash in Bangladesh, the reach they're having now in terms of the scope and scale they've achieved and the ease of payment transfer is fantastic. It really is impressive. So I'd kick off with this, although this is challenging, it's something we should be optimistic about. The important part as entrepreneurs is how do we navigate the pros and cons? How do we make sure we don't do unintentional harm while we're trying to work on the front lines of kind of this digital age, this digital space? To begin with, I think with great opportunity comes greater risks, right? So we kicked off with Twitter. I might share my political views on Twitter, or I might share my views on Facebook, but it's very unlikely in the country that I live that I would ever be put in jail by my government for sharing my political views on Twitter. That's not true other places in the world. Likewise, if my credit card or my debit card, someone gets that number and commits credit or debit card fraud, I'm not gonna be happy about it, but I'm gonna be okay. In fact, there's a good chance the bank will actually cover me for the shortfall. Now imagine an impoverished slum dweller who's using something like Bcash. Someone gets into their accounts and takes all of their savings, all of their money. Right? With the potential of digital, that's a far more catastrophic to them than it would be for us in this context. So I'd say with kind of that greater opportunity comes greater risks, which segues into, I think, the two types of risks that as entrepreneurs really to look out for. The first is a very basic technical risk of sort of deliberate or malicious misuse. And you know, that's scary. So that's the fraud side of things. That's questions around data architecture, data security. What if you're working with mobile data on the front lines and someone gets unauthorized access to it? And although this is challenging and the consequences can be really severe, it's also a technical problem. It's a solvable problem. In fact, many of the tools exist well. Building smart data architecture, however you're connecting, whether it's, you know, using OAuth 2.0, SSL, these tools exist to build robust, secure systems. And that's something we as entrepreneurs absolutely have to build into the work we do. Biometrics, critical. Absolutely essential that we encrypt the templates that we send, because this is very personal data to people. The second one that I think is more insidious and often more difficult to deal with is what we call function creep. It's when a piece of data was collected for one purpose, but gets used for another purpose. So take, for example, the United Nations biometric database. They've registered now the biometrics, 1.5 million, roughly, Syrian refugees. And they're doing it for all the right reasons. They're doing it to track the refugees as they move, make sure there's adequate access to aid supplies, stopping the problems of, for example, people who are non-refugees claiming refugee goods and running into preventing stockouts, like happened in their Mbeere refugee camp recently. This is a very good thing. What happens, though, when the Department for Homeland Security or NATO thinks there might be a bad actor amongst the refugees and would now like to access the UN's biometric database and use that data? Is that a good thing? Is that a bad thing? That's where it's going to start to get controversial. There's going to be a lot of pressure on organizations, and there's going to be a lot of pressure for to take data that we might have collected for one purpose, and our social enterprise work to do a good thing, but to maybe use that for something else. And is that such a good thing? It depends politically sometimes where you stand. Sometimes these are going to be philosophical and regulatory questions rather than technical questions. So I think to kick off this panel, this is something that as entrepreneurs we need to be very conscious of as we approach this topic.
And Juliana, you were speaking earlier about the role that you play in working with governments, particularly in Africa and Haiti, and you had some very good practical solutions of how you manage that. Will you talk about that?
Sure. I'm one of the co-founders of Ushahidi, which is a not-for-profit software company. And when it comes to this question of accountability in the digital age, it's truly a continuum. And one of the biggest lessons that we learned in terms of how the platform was used was that, one, it was important for us to make it open source so that people didn't have to start from scratch. So as entrepreneurs, as social entrepreneurs, or even people who are in the not-for-profit space, or whichever space you're in, the tools that you would need to ensure that when you're collecting the data, that some of that data, or at least the platform that you're using to collect that data, is built from a perspective of thinking about some of these questions. So when it comes to specifically handling personally identifying information, in the platform, it is built into it that it can be encrypted, it can be hashed, so that even if you get a summons, you cannot provide the data. Because the way it is architected to respect the personal identifying information. So that's number one. And then that brings to the point that you do not have to start from scratch. There are tools out there that you can look into, that you can use, or even there are frameworks, including some from the World Economic Forum, Data Development Global Agenda Council, that provides guidance for governments, for entrepreneurs, for companies to think about these philosophical policy questions. They've suggested some frameworks that talk about this question of trust and how digital data is handled. So these things, you don't have to start from scratch. It's not like you have to build all these things all the way, you know, all the way down. It's just when you're thinking about your data collection, your visualization, your presentation, or some of how you handle the data, let's learn from each other and let's learn from what has happened so far. And the other thing that we've also learned through when I was part of Ushahidi was how important feedback loops are. I'll give you an example. There is a platform, there is a municipality in Ireland. They used the Ushahidi platform and they put together a site called Fix My Street, where people in Dublin could actually say, look, there's a pothole or there's a problem in the city. And what they did that was really different from other deployments that we'd seen or how other people had used this free and open source platform is they put together the mandate that they have as a city and said, if somebody reports into this system, we will respond within 48 hours. So accountability is not only about action and response. It's about the mandate and how that interfaces with the architected system. Or does the system that you've created, does it have that input point where people can add into that particular system what they need to in order to actually do the mandate, to actually do the work. And in the case of Dublin, if somebody reported and said, this is a problem in my neighborhood, or trash was not picked up, the city would respond within 48 hours, and they would also notify them when the issue was fixed, which was incredible and such a learning point for us that our platforms need to be architected in a way that it encourages feedback loops, because that's how you can get accountability. And then last but not least, I think when you were talking about this question of what happens, actually your opening question about what happens to your data. Mm-hmm. One of the things that worries me right now, because I think there's about 20% of people in Africa currently use the internet, and there are many more coming online. How many of you here know the difference between DuckDuckGo and Google? And that's just here, right? So how do we expect the next generation of people coming online to understand the terms of service or the privacy settings of these tools that are on the internet if they do not have basic digital literacy? And so that's something that's really worrying me. And as part of brick.org, one of the questions is, how do we deliver technology to the edges of society? And we're also starting to think about this question of, what is the digital survival kit for the 21st century? We certainly need it so that we know which sites track you, which sites do not, and the future generation of people who are going to be using the internet are gonna need to know what sites, what is the internet, how did it develop, what are the issues that are coming up, and how do they protect themselves, or even how do they contribute to making tools that help protect themselves and others. So these are different questions that we're still, I'm really happy to be here to be discussing with you, as it is indeed a continuum, and we each have different points to practically add to the solutions, or perhaps even other emerging questions.
Right, so I think it still comes back to the question, who has permission to you, the individual on the internet? Because you're all doing very powerful and very good things, but if the information that you're collecting about the individual is misused, and that's misused at a group level, that's going to minimize the social impact of everything that you intended to do. So the question is, who should have permission to you? And that's really the heart of the debate around Apple versus the government. That's the heart of the debate around the Prime Minister and his publishing his tax return. So Rosaria, I want to ask you this question, because this is a very important policy question. How do we advance science in collecting really life-changing data about cures for cancer and cures for AIDS while inhibiting the access of that data so that it's not misaligned and sold to an insurance company that might say, this person's Googling about cancer or AIDS or things that, you know, I might shape their policy differently if I know that they already have a pre-existing condition. And this was an article written in the New York Times 2 weeks ago about, what if everything that you're actually searching is scraped and becomes a part of who you are in a digital environment, and an insurance company or any other company can actually change the pricing mechanism for you? So how would you think about that from a policy point of view?
Yeah. Thank you very much for the question and for the invitation. I think this is a very important question. I'm afraid there is no simple, straightforward answer because it's a complex question which requires quite a bit of a sophisticated thinking, a refined approach. But it highlights a very important issue, which is that big data, machine learning, the Internet of Things, data science, they are great new technological development which come with potential for have a huge impact on societies and on the life of individuals. But they also come coupled with ethical challenges. And the ethical challenges need to be addressed properly, because otherwise we risk losing all the benefits that technology may bring about. So the first point I would like to make to answer to your question is that we need to have some inbuilt, from the day zero, ethical consideration into the development of technology, which might be privacy by design, as you were mentioning, but also it requires foresight. It requires understanding where we're going, what kind of societies do we want to build, what kind of expectations we have towards the future. Because the question you're asking is, how do we balance technology with making sure that we don't do harm, or that we don't do too much harm, if we want to be kind of cynical in this respect. And I have to say, this is something that is becoming more and more recognized. So if you think about the European Union, for example, they are redrafting the data protection regulation, keeping in mind exactly this need. And so this new version of the regulation is being drafted with the aid of an ethical advisory board. Or if you think about the UK, a new institute for data science has been just launched, the ATI Institute, the Alan Turing Institute, and they have ethics within the research scope and interest. The goal is to develop an ethics of data science, among other things. So this is the first point. The second point takes me back to the title of this panel, which is about trust and accountability. And I think it's very, these are two core topics on which we have to focus. Along these two, I would like to throw in another topic, which is responsibilities. Responsibilities has to do with moral ground, moral standing. When you think about the trust that we have in technology, and in technology developers and providers, the thing we hold them accountable for, and the responsibility we ascribe to them, I think that it becomes clear that we have stronger expectations towards these agents, towards these actors, than we would have had 10 or 15 mm-hmm. years ago. Because we expect these actors, and I'm talking about Google, but also about NGOs, about data collectors in general, could be academics, could be scientists, so it's a very broad scope of agents. They are key agents in shaping the informational environments and societies. And so to some extent, we expect them to act as the good citizens. So we expect Apple to protect our privacy. We expect Google and Facebook to respect cultural differences. We expect scientists not to reuse data in a way that is not really ethical to some extent. So to answer to your question, I think that this new expectation, they unveil the fact that we consider these agents as agents that bear new civic responsibilities. And I'm afraid the non-simple answer that I was referring to before, it's about defining these new responsibilities, these new civic responsibilities, because then we will be able to understand what is the good for societies and what is the bad for society, which way we should steer and which way we should be try to keep away from. And this takes me to the last point I wanted to make, which is about really foresight, which is about understanding what kind of societies we are designing and building for future generation. Before she was mentioning, how do we export technology to the edge of society? How do we bridge the digital divide? This cannot be done with ad hoc solutions. This requires foresight thinking. This requires a serious moment of reflection on the future of information societies and all the world at large. So there's a lot of work to be done, likely for me, I have to say.
But is there a practical solution there? If you look at Google makes 70% of their revenue from advertising. I mean, they're scraping the internet and they're selling that very specifically to consumers who want to target you. And that's efficiency, that's machine learning, that's important. But is there a conflict of interest there that do we want everything that we do on the internet to be upsold to consumers? And booking.com is a great company and they offer fabulous service, but do you want everything that you book and everything that you do to be visible for 5 years to them and anyone else that may want access to that data? Is there a practical solution? Because really in the nonprofit world, we are no different than any other company when we're searching and that data is available unformed to the highest bidder. So is that tension manageable? Should we have, in the case of a privacy, when you look at Apple or any other company and they say, please look at our privacy terms, the privacy terms are sometimes 5 and 6 pages. You just want to get to the website, book, and get on with it. Who's going to read it? Mm-hmm. Is there an mm-hmm. argument that we should take the 3 core tenets of what's in that privacy policy? Do you want your data to be shared? You know, can I keep this indefinitely? How long may I keep it? Is it only for this moment? Or you know, you may not share anything. So maybe the 3 core tenets should be on that web page before you do any commercial activity. Maybe we truncate it and shorten it. And that would apply especially, I think, to the nonprofit world and to mm-hmm. social entrepreneurs who want to do good but really haven't thought through the privacy part of it. Mm-hmm. And I did a survey recently and I asked the question of nonprofits because I have a foundation. I'm very interested in the question of accountability. So I did a survey and I asked nonprofits, large and small, what was their privacy policy, if they had one, how often they reviewed it. So only 30% of the people that I engage with every day in the nonprofit sector had a stated privacy policy. Once they created it, they had not renewed it. They had a lawyer or someone else create a privacy policy. It had not been renewed since they had been formed. So there's also a duty of care on our side to review that, be very proactive, and maybe put the 3 key tenants up there and get permission up front. So I'd love your thoughts on that.
I and maybe this is the lens that I look through for the communities that we serve, but this whole issue of consent is putting out there and just asking permission to take your data and pass it on. Is that okay? Is that enough? We looked at a lot, and we decided that no. Even if you asked a consent, there's a lot of unknowns. Environments we work in are really complex. If some income data, let me give you a real life example, income data on some family got out there, quickly the gang could be right on top of them to try to get a kickback. By the way, this happened with a nonprofit in a community, the first picture I showed you. And it literally, the gang came and wanted the equivalent of like $20,000 a month from that nonprofit when they learned of their finances, and it shut the nonprofit down after 35 years. So even if there was a consent given, my point is there's some really intense stuff that can come out that I still think we have an obligation to cut off. And I really believe that, at least on our watch, that information is not going to get out there and get traced back down. On the business side, running an organization in these communities, the favelas or wherever, I really believe that would undermine our business as well. So we get this data, this very, very personal data. We're really up close and personal, based on trust. And again, if that gets out there and that trust is undermined, it's over. It's over in many ways, probably for us. But you know, from a business perspective, we're not going to be able to get in and get that data, go back in. And so it's also, there's a practical, from a ethical standpoint, we're looking at it, of protection, if you will. Maybe it's paternalistic or maternalistic. But I really believe, again, this could come back and bite the people in these communities, but also from the business perspective.
That's a really good point. And Juliana, you had a point?
So two points. I think maybe something that we should probably discuss is this question of who owns the data. Do each of us, how many of you here believe that you own your data? Do you own your footprint online? Do you own the data that you generate? How many of you here feel or believe that you own it?
Okay. Do or that you should?
Okay, do you believe that you should own it?
Yes.
Okay. Do you feel like you own it right now? Okay, so there's that tension, right? And I really don't have an answer other than to say that companies, and it's perhaps something that we really need to think about, how do we build in that agency so that people can feel like they own that data, and not just feel like, that they do actually can provide that consent and say, I would like for you to only use this data, only for me to get this particular service from you. It's something that, frankly, is really hard to put it back into the design, because I feel like a lot of the systems have been designed in a way that we now feel like we don't own the data, because that agency has been taken away from us.
So, and I have another question related to that. How many people really care about who sees what you search and who you are in the internet space? So if you could choose not to have your data upsold, how many of you would do that? So that's probably 50%. So it is important. Yeah. And the other question I have is, the data that's on the internet about you, does it really fully reflect who you are? And is that how you want to be represented to the world? So think about your searches, think about your travel, think about all of the things you do on the internet that form a digital you. Is that really who you are and how you want to be represented without any editing?
No. There is a website called tosdnr.org. Terms of Service Did Not Read. .org. It was put together by some really cool people in the open source world. It's a really helpful website that's helpful for me, and I hope you can check it out. It's a not-for-profit also that is really informative in terms of telling you, for this particular website, will they track you? We can use the types of companies that respect our ideals, or at least the things that we believe when it comes to this question of personal data.
So I think that's a really good place to stop and go to Q&A, because I think you've got quite a few perspectives here, each one from a different part of the world, but each one really asking the same question. So now I'd like to turn it over to you and ask you what you thought and what questions you have that you'd like some specific advice on or thoughts on or that you want to share with the group in general. Please.
So first of all, thank you very much.
Just one second, we're going to give you a microphone.
Thank you so much. So my background is in human rights work, but I happen to have members of my family, people in my community, who are tracking things like illicit finance for the government, and also who deal with pedophiles, tracking pedophiles and trying to capture them, which I believe in. I think that's important. I don't think anyone here would disagree. And it's interesting because we've gotten into some very heated conversations about this issue around data privacy. And I'm curious, you know, if we put it in the terms of do you favor, do you not, the answer is very simple. But then when you actually dig down to say, well, if somebody actually needs to get permission from a judge, the way that you would in a wiretap situation, to be able to monitor activity online for a pedophile or a network of pedophiles, for example, it becomes a lot more complex. So I'm interested in that complex discussion, mm-hmm. which is not at the surface level of do we want to own our data? Certainly. What happens if we own all of our data and then companies can't monetize and can't, you know, for me, the answer is a complex one. Do I, in principle, yes. Does that mean that therefore there are many services I won't be able to have access to because those companies can't be monetized to function? Then there's a trade-off question. What's worth it to me and what isn't? So can we go one level deeper on this conversation to actually talk about the nuance of what's difficult? Because the people, for example, in my family community, they are very progressive, human rights to the core, but when they're dealing with networks of pedophiles, they have a different set of trade-offs in terms of what they believe the privacy should look like.
And I think that goes to the heart of why this problem hasn't been solved, is that the trade-offs are enormous economically, and they're enormous scientifically, and there is no one solution that fits all. And so, Rosario, I'd love your thoughts on that, because you shared something about the most recent dilemma and the Wellcome Trust had to step in, because it's a really big challenge. So we'll go deeper on that.
Yeah, I think this is a very great question. Thank you so much. I'll start with an analogy. So someone has told that data are the new oil because everybody wants it. I think data are the new oil also because they are the key source for make this whole engine, this whole clockwork of the information society to work. If you take out data, machine learning it's not useful anymore, big data don't exist, IoT is not relevant any longer. So data is a key resource for which everybody should be very careful in sharing it and in using it and everywhere. So this is the first thing I would like to say. And the second thing is that it's important to understand that data are malleable. That means the data we collect today for a purpose can be reused for another purpose. And this could be a bad or evil or a good purpose. The example I give to my students usually is the so-called Hollerith machine. It's a machine that the German government used to run the first census. So they went house by house, checking what kind of religion you would be, how many women, how many men. 10, 15 years later, the Nazi government come up, and they knew exactly where the Jewish were because of the Hollerith machine, because of those data. So it's important to understand the malleability as well as the relevance of data for our society. I'm glad for the question you asked, because it shows that there is no one solution for all the situations. And when we talk about consent, when we talk about privacy, or when we talk about concept like data philanthropy, me being able to donate my data for medical research or for any other sort of research, the context has to be kept in mind. So I was giving this example before to Alexsis. At some point, when big data arose as a big issue, the European Union was drafting the first draft for the data protection regulation, and privacy was a big, strong topic. And we all felt we had to protect privacy because big data was there to kind of threaten our fundamental rights. The protection of privacy was so much ingrained that it poses a serious risk to the development of biomedical research, because you couldn't reuse big data that you had collected for one purpose to other research purposes. And the exception were, unless you're doing research that is socially relevant. Well, to me, if you're developing research to cure rare disease, which affect few people in Europe, that would be still socially relevant. And I would like medical research to be able to reuse those data. So the risk was so high that major academic founders like the Wellcome Trust wrote a letter to the European Commission asking to reconsider. And in fact, we are reconsidering the data protection these days. So this is an example to say that depends on the context, depends on the situation. And there are mechanisms in place to address the topic you raised. For example, the OECD released new guidelines for the consent forms, getting back to your point. And we're moving towards an understanding of consent that has to be more transparent, more comprehensible, but also dynamic. So I might change my mind, and in 10 years I might decide that I want to donate my data, or in 10 years I might decide that I don't want to give my data to anybody. And this is a way of respecting individuals. So the last point I'd like to conclude with is that if we go back to the idea of data as the new oil, so new oil as something that is very valuable, and that goes back to our data, but also as something that is necessary for society to exploit this thing, then that means that it's a resource that we have to responsibly care about, the way we would care about other, let's say, energy resources in societies. And this requires sophisticated, refined solutions. As you say, it changes from time to time, from situation to situation.
Go ahead.
Thank you. I think it's a phenomenally interesting topic. I work a lot with health data and have actually kind of just been drafting kind of health data privacy policy, because in a lot of like emerging markets, like there is no regulation in this space. And you know, when you look around, the EU is kind of redrafting their policies. You know, in the UK, you know, this need to share, especially about like health data, I think owned by the individual, but need to share is like so important in the ability to actually deliver good care, that like in the UK they had the Caldecott principles, which kind of re-reviewed this fundamental thing in terms of this modern world that we live in and that need to share, right? Because it's so fundamentally important. But I think so it comes back to a couple of things for me, which is around, you know, everybody needs to have a very clear privacy policy that's governed by the principles of the organization. That's a kind of easy thing to do. I think that the harder thing to do is to actually implement it. And I think we often kind of think that it ends at the water's edge. And it was interesting that comment about, you know, only 30% of companies even have a privacy policy. But what about all of the administrative controls? Because I think it's also easy for us to focus on the technical aspects of data protection, but actually knowing if someone's like breached your data, you know, if someone's actually, who isn't allowed to look at that personal data, you know, if that's encoded in your policy, like actually knowing that those things are happening, which I think speaks to this question of accountability and trust. Mm-hmm. And, you know, the people that will win, if you like, in this new world, whether it's social enterprises or corporations, will be those that have that reputation of, you know, actually doing what they say that they'll do. Which just brings me to my last point, because I think this question of consent, like, is so interesting, because we are so stuck in like a legal framework of like, you know, terms and conditions that are 17 pages long that nobody reads them.
No.
And especially, with, you know, like I don't read them, like people that, you know, are illiterate certainly don't read them.
Right.
So how do we kind of bridge this? And I think we need to, I just scribbled something down and I just thought I'd share it, which is that we almost need like a Creative Commons, you know, the kind of Creative Commons approach to terms and conditions, or, you know, this is what you're signing up to, you know,
yeah.
This company is actually going to sell your data, whereas this one isn't. This one says that you own this data, this one says they own this data, and make it almost like little smiley faces that, you know, makes it really, really simple.
So a truncated version of permissions, and then you as a consumer and as an individual can choose, you know, who do you want to work with, and if you're indifferent, that's fine, you'll go this way. But if it matters to you, you can choose.
Yeah.
And that sort of solves a problem of, is it wide open or not, and how do we get very specific on it? There is a choice, but first of all, most privacy policies are not reviewed dynamically, so the law is changing, software is changing, but the policy is static. So the enforceability when someone does something wrong is so far behind that there is no enforceability if there's bad behavior. Mm-hmm. So I think, you know, your point is very, very important about rewarding good actors and penalizing those that don't really honor the code of protecting you, the individual.
That, there's a useful analogy here, which is food labeling. So the food manufacturers used to lose the calories, fat, and salt in their products in impenetrable data that nobody read. And then they were sort of compelled, sort of arm-twisted, sort of browbeaten into the little green, amber, red. And you can just pick up a ready meal and say, well, that's really bad for me, regardless of who manufactures it. And so it doesn't have to be legislation or Creative Commons. There's a place in the middle where you kind of leverage it.
A very practical solution, because the question is so large that it's so large we don't even try and solve it. But maybe if we broke it down and had more practical solutions of, like this company, we'll deal with them, versus don't like this company, they're selling every aspect of who I am. So maybe it's as simple as that. That's a great example.
I think people will often push if they have the information in front of them, if they understand the implications. And you're going to need that push when we think about regulatory frameworks of data. So what you were talking about, actually having a legal landscape that's consistent and is robust and consumer friendly. Mm-hmm. We'd recently got asked in a project in Nepal by the Nepali government for super admin access rights. So it's a health project we're working with, biometric data linking patients through a biometric ID to health records. On principle, it's great trying to set up, make sure that it plays within the Nepali regulatory framework. And the government came back and asked, okay, fantastic, but we want a password and a username that gives us access to all of that data. So we push back really hard. It's a massive concern. But their argument back is, look, there's also not just an individual responsibility to data, but from a government perspective, what if someone catches tuberculosis or a rare case of, say, polio, or some disease that they're trying to tap down and actually presents a public healthcare risk? Is there also a collective responsibility for data as well? So as entrepreneurs, it's a really tricky and constantly shifting landscape with lots of gaps. We've got to navigate it. There isn't going to be a simple solution.
So Pamela, I think you had a question.
I'm just wondering, even in the cases where, you know, like in the case of mobile metrics, where you say, we never give the data to anybody, we guard the data, or Toby also in terms of what you're doing, where do you store that data? How long does that data live for? Is there an auto-destruct date where, you know, people can no longer get at that? And obviously this is the heart of what Apple is going through, et cetera. How do we protect, really, because that data is still there, even if you say, oh, we don't give it out? I'm curious about that. I'm very non-technical in these areas, but I can imagine that, you know, I mean, I sort of think of a big recycling plant, landfill with all this data or whatever.
Well, yeah. Well, best practice is that you never, certainly in the social entrepreneur spaces, best practice is you never collect data that you do not need. So you start with, the temptation is to do a very big survey, and you maybe only need 20% of that data. So first of all, you only want to ask what's relevant to your research or what the issue at hand is. Secondly, you have a policy of, once you're done with that research, you destroy it, and you say that up front to the people that you're surveying. This data will be used for this project, and then it is wiped clean, and that can be 6 months or a year. So I think best practice dictates only ask for really what you need to get your project done, not everything else. And secondly, put in there, it's going to be, after we've used it and done the computations, we will destroy it.
Is that the reality?
For a lot of scientific research where it's very sensitive private data, that is the case. And it should be, I think, the case maybe more so universally, that the data is destroyed. And I think you have a comment.
So,
just a comment on exactly this issue. So president of World Reader, we're trying to get 1 billion people reading. So the only way to get 1 billion people reading is to use technology and to make sure that books go directly to cell phones and other devices that people already have or will have. We get 2.5 million people every month reading books on our cell phone apps, all the way through India, through Africa, through the developing world. So that's fantastic, and I'm very proud of our accomplishments. We have 35,000 books we've digitized. Many of those books are local books in languages that, you know, very few people speak. So that's all wonderful. At the same time, we feel an enormous sense of obligation, because we've talked a lot about sort of medical records here and survey information. Reading information is very private as well, right? And I can tell you, for example, that in the aggregate, the girls in Kenya, if they're 16 years old, there's a very good chance they've read a book called Male Condom Instruction. Very, very good chance. You know, almost, you know, 100% chance based on the look we do at this. So I bring that up because the reason they might feel comfortable reading something like that on a phone is they assume it is private, right? They assume that no one's going to watch them. They're not going to be asking someone for this information or reading it in a public way. I have to say, it's very, very technically and economically challenging to keep that private. And it sounds like it should be easy, but it's not. I mean, private is easy. That's a policy. But you know, withstand attacks if people wanted to attack us for that information. I mean, very big companies lose their way all the time on this. Well-meaning companies with very large financial incentives not to let this data sort of creep out into the open, and so forth. So I guess the comment I'm making is the expense, both sort of the cognitive load that we have, the sort of responsibility we have, but also the financial load that we as nonprofits take on when we get data like this, is significant. And actually, I guess I have a plea a bit for funders in the room. Funders, I wouldn't say are particularly sensitive to this issue. I don't know that we've ever really gotten a question around any of these issues, which is interesting. And simultaneously, you know, there are not a lot of funders out there raising their hands saying, yeah, we'd like to, you know, write a $1 million check to help reinforce the systems that organizations like yours are creating. So sort of an observation that these are complicated issues, not just around health information, but about education information, and that data can form an incredibly important and interesting and very helpful for us portrait of what people want to find out more about and what people are reading and what people are not reading but want to read more of and so forth. But we take that responsibility very seriously, and we're very aware that it's expensive and complicated to continue to manage this area. So thank you for giving us the forum to talk about it a little bit.
Absolutely.
Back to Pamela's question on mobile metrics, and probably most of us here, most of the data is all encrypted, and so that makes it much harder. But then again, as you guys have been reading, a lot of that is getting hacked these days, so that's not even a guarantee. So after the end of a project, the personal data gets stripped off, but the aggregated data is always there. And as I mentioned, the aggregated data in our case goes back to the company. They never get the personal data. After 1 year, we have a contract that says that data also comes back to Mobile Metrics. So because we believe that there's really great learnings over time to in having a centralized database of data. And we do a lot of longitudinal studies, which means kind of a before and after. You know, there's usually an intervention of some sort in between. And so being able to keep that over time and compare and contrast. We also have three types of data we always collect. There's mobile metrics data, which we collect no matter where we are. That's the stuff that tends to get really personal and about expenses and income and that type of thing. Then the second is obviously what the company is interested in collecting, which a lot of times gets into competitive information, stuff like that, which a lot of organizations aren't interested in having that except for their competitors. And then we always offer it to the community leadership in those communities to put in 5 to 10 questions of their own that go back to them as well. So that's what happens to, again, trying to make it, I think it's always a balance, right? But it's trying to create that win-win between all sides. You know, so Mobile Metrics has a win, the company has a win, and what we would call our primary client, which are the community residents, have the greatest win of all.
So there was one more question. I think you in the back had a question.
Yes, you kind of answered it in passing. It was the question of the data that they collect in the transaction or the service that's being provided by the online, the digital platform. But there's the data that they could collect. And I'm not sure if they do or don't. For example, every time I download an app, I have to give permission for them to have access to my pictures, my contacts, my emails.
Correct.
And I don't know how much data mining is taking place behind my back and what happens to that. And you mentioned that
quite a
best
lot.
Practices.
Quite a lot. Quite a lot. So any other questions or observations? I'm sorry, yes, you had one.
I just had a very small observation picking up on what Juliana said about when they were in Germany collecting data about people's ethnicity. They did the same in Holland and Amsterdam, and when the Nazis came in, they had the record of exactly where all the Jews lived. And there was a guy called Geert van der Veen who actually went in and set fire to the census office. And he paid a heavy price for it, as did a lot of people in Amsterdam that got shot by the Nazis for doing it. But it just made me think, is there a way when we see data that's being abused? I mean, things were much simpler those days, I realize. But would there be a way, if we see data being abused, that somebody could go and set fire to that data, maybe through hacking or something? I know it's a strange analogy, but there's got to be ways to stop people.
Yeah, I think it's a very interesting question.
It's a very interesting question. I think that there are many lessons to be learned by the Hollerith machine history and similars. One is that oversight is necessary. I would be generally skeptical about the one man action or the one man decision, because that can flip on any side of the story. But there has to be oversight. There has to be perhaps distributed oversight. I also wanted to make a small comment about what we said before about personal information. I think that's a very important point. I mean, we speak about biomedical research because that's something that kind of touches people more deeply. Everybody wants to be healthy and live longer and so on and so forth. But all data about ourselves, they all deserve the same importance, the same relevance, because they contribute to the building of our identity, to the construction of who we are, as you were saying before. So I think it's important to remark that it's about every kind of data, not just, like in the history of the Hollerith machine, it's all possible data about us that are relevant.
Sorry.
My observation was that there's also the data that you're collecting, but there's also the underlying data that the device is collecting by just the person that's collecting the data being in the location itself. So you're talking about GPS coordinates, you're talking about the movements of people and the safety and the security of those people who are doing the collection for your organizations or your companies. And I think that oftentimes that data kind of gets melded into the data and the storage of the data and puts companies and organizations at an increased risk for hacking and that they're not really looking at. And what measures, I know that with our organization at Vedera, we take very hard and very concrete measures to make sure that none of that metadata gets attached to the videos and that we produce and that we distribute.
How do you do that? I mean, specifically, how do you do that?
That we use materials that don't connect, so that we basically kind of black
box. So it's your endpoint connections.
So that we use lots of physical physical and old school non-digital ways of transmitting data to make sure that these metadata points aren't submitted. Other organizations do this by breaking off the data and collecting it back at endpoints through encryption mechanisms. Right. And there's various ways that people are doing that now. But I think that's also a way, as we kind of transmit data, and I think it's in the transmission of that data, not just in the storage, that we kind of open ourselves up to risk at that kind of in-between point. Yeah.
I think three very practical things you can do if you're working with data on the front lines. One, think about the architecture. Like Juliana said, there's a lot you can do by building smart architecture up front, both in terms of double encryption so you can't access the data or access your user's data, but also just in terms of either auto-delete or getting rid of things, or just being careful what you collect in the first place. The second is legal. There has to be a space for sort of the legal and regulatory frameworks. So either working with people to understand those and apply those, or if you're working in a place that doesn't have them, adopt voluntarily one that's pretty good. Like, we voluntarily adopt European data, just because those regulations, they're pretty tough. And that forces us to be strict even in places where it's not required. And the third thing to do, and this is often the toughest, is choose what's going to be your ethical standard, because there's more of an onus on us in the room to do that. Companies aren't going to play by the same rules, but the risk of us not doing that is even greater, because the cost could be so much more if that data is misused, especially with really vulnerable populations. It's not easy. There's rarely like a simple solution, but just playing by sort of the technical and the legal rules isn't far enough. You need to go that extra step.
So last question, please.
I think we're sort of in human rights section over here. I'm with Benetech, and we do secure data collection in the human rights space, where it's really still in some places becoming understood that that's critical. And what I find when we talk to broader NGOs, and I'm really glad we're having this discussion, is just there isn't this awareness about this whole issue of security, how you store it, how you collect it. You know, if you're out on a mobile phone, is it actually secure when it's in the mobile phone if somebody's phone gets grabbed? So I guess I just really want to open up the question to how do we make this more known and also convince all of our fellow NGOs that, you know, yes, there's a technical piece of this and it isn't super easy, but that it can be done. And, you know, how do we just sort of make sure that word gets out that this isn't optional anymore?
Well, I think that's the point of this discussion, is that it raises the awareness, but I think it's also an essential part of doing due diligence on any organization is, one of the first things I do is I look at the privacy policy. Do you have one? What's it say? How long am I protected? So I think really putting that in a due diligence list. So, how often have you ever seen your privacy policy in a due diligence list? How often has that ever been a donor requirement that they want to know if you have one in place and if it's reviewed yearly? Mm-hmm. And is the data cleaned? Is it deleted? Really that's how it starts, is that from a donor and from a social entrepreneur point of view, very proactively making this front and center. Mm-hmm. Because it starts with the individual managing, I think, their own personal data, and that forces all of the institutions in your ecosystem to say, this one is paying attention, we have to pay attention. Mm-hmm. So that would be my first recommendation. So one last question, sorry, because you were very patient.
Thank you. Another person from the human rights sphere. I'm with Global Witness. I just wanted to relate something that we went through. We investigate issues of corruption and related issues to natural resources. And one of the cases we were looking at was an Israeli mining billionaire called Benny Steinmetz, who did a corrupt deal in Guinea, which cost the government $2.5 billion. And he is now being investigated by law enforcement in about 5 or 6 countries relating to this deal. He tried to hit us under the UK Data Protection Act with a subject access order, i.e. he was asking us for all the data we had with his name on it. The name of his company is Benny Steinmetz Group Resources. And he said, because it's got my name, it's my personal data, therefore under this act, I should be able to get this information. And had he got that, he was getting it presumably to service his defense in his various legal cases and to be aggressive to us, but it would have endangered the sources we had, and had it gone through, it would have been a precedent that would have affected any NGO who carries out any investigative activity. We fought it, and we won it, which was really, really lucky. But I just think if anyone's working in other jurisdictions, because we can use this as precedent in the UK, it's something to really think about. I just wanted to pass that on.
That's an excellent point. And with that, we'll close the session and say thank you very much. And I hope your takeaway is you will proactively ask about the privacy policy and monitor it. Thank you.